Los Angeles when he was in his teens. While David grew up in luxury houses, 2,000 square feet saved him from financial difficulty in his awful life. His father, who built his wealth in a traditional and conservative background, he was no stranger to show business. One of his uncles, Manny Roth, had owned Cafe Bois, a club in New York's Greenwich Village. David had grown up seeing incredible luminaries such as Hendrix, Dylan, and Springsteen. Maybe it was because of this that he became obsessed with stardom. He told me on numerous occasions, and I quote, that he was going to be famous. He wasn't just saying, he was declaring. I was destined to be famous. It didn't embarrass him to admit it either. Actually, I think he viewed it as a noble, particularly practical ambition. Let me just imagine the scandal of stating his affirmation for an imaginary audience. I am going to be famous. He certainly was. No question about that. Maybe he was right. Maybe he turned his dreams into reality through sheer force of will. By the way, it was impressive. David's obvious and valuable talents in some areas counterbalanced his over-the-top behavior in others, both on and off the stage. Edward was the most talented and artistically gifted member of the band. David was the brightest, the most broadly creative, with a vision that went well beyond simply playing music and getting laid. Yes, his intelligence was equaled and sometimes obviated by his bombastic, demanding, and occasionally cruel behavior. Diamond Dave was a hyperactive showman from the start, ultimately a diva of the first order. His mighty tantrums frequently gave those around him the sense that disaster was imminent. But he did have a vision for Van Halen and for himself, and he made that vision a reality. He had help, of course. There's no question that among the four members of the band, David was the true leader. He was also a true opportunist. I always found it interesting that, although David never changed his name, he rarely discussed or openly embraced his Jewish heritage. Rock stars are supposed to ooze sex appeal, and the Jewish stereotype did not fit that image. Jews were seen as accountants and bookkeepers, financial managers and attorneys. They were doctors like his father. Being a Jew myself, I was confused and irritated by David's apparent shame and his tendency to paint with a broad brush. Jews aren't sexy. Talk about the Bob Dylan, Billy Joel, Leonard Cohen, Lou Reed, Simon and Garfunkel, Lenny Kravitz, and any number of other Jewish recording artists. Jews can't be rock and roll stars. Quick, someone better let Gene Simmons know before Kiss puts out another rock hit. Hell, it had been that sexy Jew in question that helped discover them. Kidding aside, it was a silly and narrow-minded point of view. But I understood that it came from a place of insecurity. Yes, you can be insecure and simultaneously have a big ego. The industry is loaded with artists who fit that description. So, I mostly just let it go. Edward, music always came first. Stardom was simply a part of the deal. Not that he didn't partake in the perks that came with being a rock star, but I always got the sense that Edward had a purity of purpose. He wanted to completely reinvent the way guitar-based rock and roll was played. He may not have been the smartest guy in the room, musically, the man was a genius. Edward created sound with his guitar like nothing anyone had ever heard before. He was an innovator, a shaker. That was important to him. To say the least, he was dedicated to his craft. Perhaps it was destiny, perhaps it was fate, or maybe perseverance and a little bit of luck. But the Van Halen brothers became the backbone of their band, spending countless hours fine-tuning their work and sharpening their abilities. So it's no wonder David decided, after a mammoth that outlived its usefulness, to name the band after them. There's some question as to whose idea it really was to call the band Van Halen. David's long taken credit for the switch, which occurred in 1974. To anyone who knows him and his oversized ego, this would seem to be an uncharacteristically magnanimous suggestion. I don't think so. Somewhere underneath Ed's rough, unrefined exterior, David recognized instantly that he just witnessed the greatness in the making. This kid is a genius. Let him have the name. David later told me that he loved the sound of the name, that it was about more than just an acknowledgement of its founding brothers, but simply a cool fucking name. It was simple, declarative, and powerful. Man Hail. Smart. He understood that in order to make his dream come true, he needs some extraordinarily talented on his team. He knew that Edward, his natural gift and consistent dedication to cultivating it, was already on an upward trajectory toward fame. David responded accordingly by doing whatever he could to be a part of Edward's musical vision and by magnifying his own strengths, charisma, a strong sense of humor, and a personal brand of creativity. Also, he could jump pretty freaking high. He had a lot of dreams, and he spent as much time in his own little world as he did trying to push the crap out of this world. I certainly don't need to minimize David's contributions to his early days, nor do I need to imply that he merely rode Edward's coattails. Having spent considerable time with both men, they had an unusual degree of insight into their complex relationship. They were friends, partners, rivals. By the time the name was changed, the band's backyard shows were becoming so large and unruly that police intervention was often warranted. A new bass player had been added to the lineup. His name was Michael Anthony Soluzzi. Although Ben Anthony has no longer high stage name, Michael Anthony. Why Michael chose to legally change his name to work with me in his ethnic background, born in Chicago, was the home of his city. I do not know. Like to share his deepest feelings. He was sweet, likable, and ultimately a bit of a loner. A former baseball player, he had played in several bands by the time he got to know Edward when the two were taking classes at Pasadena City College. When Mark Stone left the band, Edward offered Michael a chance to audition as his replacement. He passed the audition and accepted an invitation to become the final member of Van Halen. While he may not have been the greatest bass player, Michael was a solid supporting player whose most underrated skill might have been his ability to provide backing vocals during live performances. He actually had a very nice voice and was perhaps a more technically proficient singer than David. Of course, there's more that goes into David's just proficiency. Michael certainly had neither David's charisma nor his unique stage presence. He was content to be a role player and filled that role exactly as it was written.